Greetings, this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. As you all know, we tend to cover the story of Tesla from a different angle than most companies. Today's focus is a question, which is Elon Musk showing that he's a scale supply chain rookie? Bonjour, Vigates for States, no kit, Moss, Firebind, and this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. After watching the Elon Musk presentation on the Model 3 on the 28th, I was fascinated kind of reviewing the elements of what he brought forward. And one of those items that was sort of playing in my mind is I read a story by one of the Mercedes executives where they reviewed the advantages and disadvantages of Mercedes versus Tesla. And one of the things they talked about was the fact that Tesla has a disadvantage when it comes to scale manufacturing of cars, which is an advantage that Mercedes has over Tesla. And so I was sort of thinking about this after watching the display of Elon Musk and company, and I was fascinated by one of the things that popped to mind that was mind-blowing, and that is the fact that he showed some things that show that he / and his staff may be supply chain rookies when it comes to little things that you do to better manage your supply chain. And a great example is illustrated by Dell Corporation, which is the photo that I chose to show you. So one of the things that Dell developed as a technique was that Dell, in a place called Round Rock, Texas, requires their major suppliers to install a building right next door to their manufacturing plant. And what happens there is that if you call Dell and order something, Dell will engage in activity where they will order the part to complete your order from next door, and it will literally come through the wall after you've placed that order. So the process is that they will put together, box your order, and ship it to you, and you will have paid for that order, and they still have terms on the items that have been used. So for example, Intel Corporation is one of their largest suppliers. They will take delivery of an Intel chip to go in your computer immediately. They will bill and get the money from you immediately, but they're getting 30 to 90 day terms from Intel. So basically, by having supply chains set up the way they are, they know and control the inventory that's next door in the Intel building, but they only take delivery to their facilities once the order has been taken and paid for, allowing Intel to help finance their business in the process. Plus, by knowing the inventory that's next door, they can also control if and when anything might be late. They already know ahead of time what that might be. So I mention this because if you review the video of Elon Musk and company, you'll notice that they engage in a behavior where he showed a screen where 54% of his items are US-based that he's ordering from suppliers, and the remainder is a global supply chain. I was really fascinated by this because it kind of explained why he said they were entering manufacturing hell. But part of entering manufacturing hell is your inexperience and your plan is shaky, so all the fire putouts that you're doing a reflection of sort of being a rookie and having not done things at scale prior. So another item I wanted to suggest here, and there's a problem with what I just described as to why Elon is not doing this, is that they have a second problem, which is if you notice the Gigafactory and the main plant where the Model 3 is being produced, they're about 130 miles apart across a mountain range. Hopefully snowstorms don't affect this, but I have actually gotten stuck in the Reno area for a whole week during an unexpected major storm. So their supply chain can be jeopardized even between Tesla properties by snow or heavy weather in those mountains where those roads actually do get shut down on occasion. So I wanted to bring this up because I was thinking to myself, shoot, if Elon Musk gave me 72 hours, I could have a temporary facility up right next to the Gigafactory and give me a week, and I could have one to, or at least two completed Model 3s out of that plant starting 1 week from when we started setting up, if I have access to the global supply chain to order my parts. And then from there, for that temporary facility, you know, after a couple of weeks, I could easily add 100 or 200 units per week to whatever the production schedule is going to be at the main plant. So if you look at the aerial on the facility that they operate in currently, they have a real supply chain issue there because there's no space to store large amounts of products heading into the vehicles that are being produced. So they're going to end up just with large numbers of tractor trailers lined up trying to bring in and take in raw materials or parts and take away finished goods. And so I also wonder if it's wise to even consider trying to manufacture the three in their current location, because it's one of the most expensive locations for manufacturing space in the world. And you know, they have a decent sized facility, but for the number of vehicles they're going to be pushing through there, that facility is way too small. So hence, you end up having to do a juggling trick to get inventory through there quickly. I actually thought that when it was announced they're going to go to 500,000 units a year, it would work out fine because Tesla has been manufacturing somewhat at scale. But there's a big difference between running a line at 25,000 cars or SUVs a quarter and running 5,000 vehicles a week. So that regular quarterly production run has now become a weekly production run. So in theory, those lessons would be transferable. But given the space constraints they have, I could see why currently he talked about this being manufacturing hell. And I would not be surprised to see if things like weather, or as he described, he's not getting his materials from next door. So Elon showed off his supply chain, and it's quite clear that he's not getting his materials from a proximate location. So this creates further problems, which is, you know, what if there are weather issues or other things associated with the supply chain outside of the United States, and therefore introducing issues as well, which is another reason why having that, requiring your supplier base to have warehouses within 10 miles of your current location with inventory that can be looked in on by the computers within Tesla is a way smarter move than what he's trying to pull off currently. So I'm anticipating they're going to have all kinds of cost overruns related to having to throw parts that could have arrived by barge or by ship, by airplane or other more costly methods to feed that supply chain, given that there are unexpected hiccups in the normal sort of delivery process. Hiccups for places or supply chain like this can include, what if there's a strike on the docks in Oakland, California, or the docks in Los Angeles, or the docks from which, from Germany or other places from which the stuff is being shipped. So you take all those what-ifs out by telling your suppliers you're either going to be next door or within 5 miles, or we don't buy from you. One other supply chain rookie move that I was exposed to that I was a little bit surprised by is that I went to the Tesla store in Washington, D.C., and in the January timeframe of this year, I got a chance to look at what was available there. And one of the things I noted about the tires is that they were running Michelins on most of the vehicles on the floor. And in my last visit in late May, early June, there was one vehicle that was running Goodyear. It was a high-performance S vehicle. The other vehicles were running Continental tires. So I thought this was fascinating, because what this put in my mind as well is that if you're stocking tires to be put on the vehicles, by sticking with one brand or manufacturer, that simplifies your supply chain further, so that it's easier to meet demand, because you're putting the same tires on all the cars. It's not going to be the same, you know, the customers will have ordered different items based on performance or not, but staying with one manufacturer makes the supply chain, again, a little bit easier, rather than trying to blend suppliers on any part, and tires kind of take up a decent amount of space. So I think that, you know, that would be a smart move as well. So I hope you guys found this interesting. Again, I believe that Tesla has shown itself to be a little bit of a rookie when it comes to supply chain management related to manufacturing. And I think that when you introduce weather, when you introduce strikes, when you introduce unexpecteds to it, by not having your suppliers required to be proximate to where you're manufacturing, you're begging for punishment. And by the way, I didn't even introduce the fact that there's worse traffic in the world, but, you know, the San Francisco Bay Area, and particularly where they're located, has some of the ugliest rush hour traffic anywhere in the United States. So that's even another variable that could affect the movement of those parts. Thank you again for taking time out to spend time with us. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Tschüss, Max Kuto, Foua, tout à l'heure, la Hitra Hot, Hoda Hafez, Salam Alaikum. Look forward to our next opportunity to chat. Have a great day. Thanks. Bye. And please like and subscribe for more insightful introductions to Tesla.